screaming baby. You run all day at the speed of life, and every day you feel a little bit less like the beautiful woman you are. So you fall into bed when you run out of hours, and you wonder if anything worth doing got done. Maybe you just don't know. Time making history with every touch and every smile. Oh, you may not see it now, but I believe time will tell how you are changing the world one little heartbeat at a time. Many little things seem to go unnoticed. They're just like the drops of rain over time. They become a river in you. You are changing the world one little heartbeat at a time, making history with every touch and every smile. Oh, you may not see it now, but I believe that time will tell how you are changing the world one little heartbeat at a time.
Whether you're up all night with a screaming baby, or you're tired of running at the speed of life in motherhood, the fact is, you can do it. Allow those little heartbeats to bring you back to life.
You are changing the world one little heartbeat at a time, making history with every touch and every smile. Oh, you may not see it now, but I believe that time will tell how you are changing.
Happy Mother's Day, North Park, Stratford. I'm Jordan Berta, pastoral resident, and I just feel honored to be able to come into your home today and start off what's going to be a wonderful time of worship and studying the scriptures, wherever you are and whatever time you are watching this. Just a reminder, though, that last week we started a family worship service, and that service has all of the content, the worship, and the message. But it also now includes a portion for kids. So if you have kids and you want to engage in that, I'm going to encourage you to stop this video, go over on whatever platform you're watching to the family worship service and engage in that video together. I just want to take a moment as we're beginning and acknowledge that Mother's Day can be a challenging day for many. Watching the video earlier reminded me of the power of motherhood. And that power perhaps is noticed most in its absence. But I also know this, that God is present with us. He joins us in our celebration. He joins us in our pain. So let's take a moment and pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for being with us in all times of life. And for those that are celebrating Mother's Day today, God, I pray that you would be with them, and I thank you for celebrating alongside them. But also for those that are struggling deeply, for any variety of reasons, God, I thank you that you are near to the brokenhearted, that you are with us in our pain and in our struggle. And Lord, I thank you for that. Would you maybe give us a special dose of comfort and joy on what can be a challenging day? Lord, I thank you for your presence, and I thank you for your peace. And I pray blessing over everyone in the sound of my voice right now. In Jesus' name, amen. I just want to also remind you that there are so many different ways to connect with us at North Park Stratford during this online ministry season. Now, the best way is to go to northpark.ca/subscribe, where every week we send you a newsletter that has a devotional as well as upcoming events and updates as to how you can engage in the ministry of North Park Stratford, because we are here. We are ready to serve, and we just want to be a part of your lives in any way that we can. We are also active on Facebook and Instagram, and we now have a YouTube channel as well. And maybe you're watching this service on YouTube, and so I just want to say, hey, everybody. We have a number of different ways to connect, and we hope that you continue to stay in touch with us on one of those preferred methods. A bit later in the service, Pastor Kirk will be kicking off our new series entitled Stronger. And it is our prayer that as a church and as individuals, that we become stronger in our faith and our relationship with Jesus. But for now, I invite you to join us in a time of worship.
Hello, North Park Church. It is great to be with you once again. Even if it is in this online format, it is wonderful to have you with us. And we are once again looking forward to a great time of worship together and a great time of teaching. Wherever you are, we hope that this video will be a blessing to you in your faith journey. I want to begin today with just a passage of scripture to help inspire our worship. And it comes from Psalm 63, a psalm of David. And it says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands." And in that spirit, today we are going to worship together. So let's sing together. As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing. Lord, we've come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed because of your love. As we come into your presence, we remember that you poured out so freely from above.
Lord, we've come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we change. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up. Are you?
Everybody, it is great to see you. My name is Matt Loveday, and I'm the pastor of Family Ministries here at North Park.
And my name is Gabriel Loveday. I'm his son, and I'm in grade 5. And together, we'd like to welcome you to our online services at North Park Community Church,
where even in a time of social distancing and physical separation, we can still gather together to worship God and to remind one another of the mission that we share.
To inspire, support, and mobilize one another.
To live more like Jesus so that we can be a transforming and life-giving presence
in our families, community, and world.
And some of our good friends who help us live more like Jesus are the members of our family ministries team. and we've asked them to pray for us today.
Lord God, thank you for our beautiful, vibrant North Park community of faith. While we are physically separated, we are spiritually united. Lord, you are our provider for all of our needs, and today we pray for continued strength to care for each other during this time.
We are grateful for our families, both in our homes and at a distance. Family by definition and not by definition. We are grateful for friendships that are new and friendships that are old. And we're grateful for the support and encouragement that these relationships provide for us each day. Even when this unique time can bring forward conflict and frustration and division, we humbly ask for patience with one another, and that you would protect these relationships in our lives and continue to draw us towards one another instead of apart.
On this Mother's Day weekend, we thank you for our mothers, grandmothers, and great-grandmothers, including the ones who have chosen to step into our lives as spiritual mothers. Thank you for the investments these women have made. We pray you will watch over them, protect them, encourage them, and continue to grow their faith and trust in you. Would you draw all women to you and transform their lives?
Father, we thank you for our preschoolers, children, youth, and young adults, and the great resilience they have shown over the last number of weeks. Through the trials and hardships of having quickly to adapt to a different world, all while not being able to see family or friends, you have proven to be faithful still. Lord, may they look back and see the evidence of your love all around them. We pray that in the midst of this, their relationships with friends would become stronger, that their love for their parents would become stronger, and most importantly, that their love for you would become stronger.
And God, we just want to thank you that your love and your faithfulness never fails, that it never fails today, never failed yesterday, and it won't fail tomorrow. We just thank you for that. And during the season, though we are human and though we can sometimes forget your faithfulness and your love for us, may we just experience that in new ways this season. And may our trust in you and our faith in you just grow stronger individually, as families, and as a community. So we just thank you for all this. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Well, hey, church, we trust that you've enjoyed our service so far, and I hope you enjoyed that little video. It was a lot of fun to make as well. You know, I've got a love-hate relationship when it comes to exercise. I love the idea of it, but I hate actually doing it. Like, I know some of you cannot relate to that. Some of you love exercise, and you post out workout videos and pictures of yourself getting exercise all the time. But on behalf of those of us who rarely exercise, or we do it but we hate it, I'm just asking you, stop it. Just Stop it. You know, the only thing worse than CrossFit are people who talk about CrossFit. Yeah, we know how in shape you are. We know how hard you've worked. Just pass me the ice cream and chocolate sauce, please, and let's move on with our day. Well, we all know that exercise is actually good for us. So why do so many of us actually work to avoid it? Well, I think there's a couple of reasons for that. First, many of us have had that day where we decide we're gonna get in shape, so we go and we work out and we feel really good after, until the next morning comes and we're stiff and we're sore and you can barely move. It feels like you're in a virtual body cast and you walk around like you're a mummy from a 1930s horror film. You can barely move. But secondly, it can also be really challenging to develop a healthy habit when results are slow and the work is hard. Working past the pain and creating the rhythms to succeed is really challenging for a lot of people. I can't tell you how many times I've woken up early to go jogging as part of a new routine to get healthier, and then I stop after just 1 or 2 days because I'm too tired and too sore then to get out of bed at 6 o'clock in the morning. But just as it's important to develop exercise in order to develop a healthy body, I think it's also important that we develop a healthy, strong faith. You know, a weak faith only looks for rescue from problems. A strong faith, it stays steady when life gets hard. A weak faith only asks God for things. A strong faith is willing to listen to God, change, and grow. A weak faith demands that God does things. A strong faith trusts God, even when we don't understand what's happening. A weak faith focuses on self, but a strong faith focuses on God and others. Now, I think for us to get stronger in our faith, we're going to have to do some spiritual training. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8 says this, "Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come." You know, Paul's encouraging Timothy to train himself to be godly because it's got value not only just for this lifetime, but for all eternity. Right? There's spiritual benefits to this type of training that are going to impact your faith now and will impact your eternal relationship with God, which is why we're going to embark on this new series that we've called Stronger. Paul the Apostle, in his letter to the church in Ephesus, says he invites us to make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. He means that time is against us. So we need to look around and see what the opportunities that our circumstances will afford us. And as I've been praying for you and for our church and contemplating the times that we're in, my heart is that you and I would come through this COVID-19 crisis with a stronger faith in God, with a deeper relationship with him, that you and I would develop the healthier, stronger habits that would lead us to more intimacy with Jesus. So for the next 8 weeks, we're going to go through some biblical practices that will help you develop a stronger faith in God. And today we're going to start out with a workout for our minds as we talk about meditation. Do you want to pray with me? Jesus, thanks for today. Thanks for your goodness and for your love. And as we move into the Word of God, would you bless us? Would you speak to us and would you challenge us? We love you and we are listening for you in the name of Christ. And all God's people around the world and at home said, Amen. Now, I can feel some of you just sat up a little bit straighter in your chairs or on your couches when I mentioned the word meditation. For some, the word connotates this images of New Age mysticism, sitting cross-legged under a waterfall, becoming one with the universe. And while some people actually do that, meditation actually has roots in the Bible. There's actually over 42 biblical references to meditation. And the word can mean to consider, to reflect upon, to contemplate, to think upon, and other things like that. Meditation in the biblical sense is about quieting and focusing our minds so that we can hear God's voice and respond. But if the definition and the point of meditation is to quiet and focus our minds so we can hear God's voice and respond, why do so few people actually practice it? I can think of at least three reasons. First, they have an aversion to stillness. Some people lack the ability to be still, to be unproductive. For some of these people, and you might be one of them, you may try to gain value. You gain importance from productivity. The more you do, the better you feel. And stopping and not doing anything feels like a waste of time. Nathan Foster, in his book, The Making of an Ordinary Saint, says that stillness is an affront to our idols of efficiency, of hurry, noise, and distraction. Spirituality with no concretely defined goals and objectives can be threatening. We almost always value purpose over mystery. Did you catch that? We value purpose over mystery. And I think there's a great challenge in there for us. If the idea of being still and just listening seems like a colossal waste of time to you, I encourage you to consider the words of Abraham Lincoln, who is known for his energy and his productivity. And he said, "Give me 6 hours to chop down a tree, and I will spend the first 4 sharpening the axe." Spending time in Christian meditation will actually help sharpen your ability to hear God and to strengthen your faith. I think the second thing that keeps people from participating in meditation is boredom. Do you remember being bored before we had smartphones with thousands of game apps available, before we had Netflix and Amazon to provide us with more TV and movies than anyone could ever watch in a lifetime? You know, we've developed this culture in the last few years where we've eliminated boredom. And I think it's actually hurt us as a society. It's made us so entertainment needy that when we try to do something like Christian meditation, we encounter boredom, and it easily and unfamiliarity makes us quit it because we just don't like the feeling of being bored. We're not used to it. But if we can overcome that barrier, and if we can push past the boredom, we may just hear that still, small voice that is speaking to us. I think third thing that can keep people from engaging with Christian meditation are simply distractions. Learning to focus is a needed skill set today. Even when I'm sitting at work at my desk, I get distracted by emails constantly popping up, by text messages and Instagram messages and Facebook messages all dinging on different devices simultaneously, begging for my attention. I get distracted by hunger, and lately I've been distracted by being cold all the time at the church. I get distracted by people when I'm at home talking to me, wandering by, and I get distracted by those same games I use to ward off boredom on my cell phone. Nathan Foster also writes this. He says, "I used to think multitasking was a virtue to strive for. It is not. The forgotten art of focusing on one task at a time is a treasure, a joy, and the gateway to a life of prayer." Christian meditation requires us to ruthlessly eliminate distractions so that instead of the noise of life, we hear the voice of God. But all barriers aside, right, there's some amazing benefits to Christian meditation. It can help you to reduce stress as you put your busyness aside and focus, and it can help you fight some of those mental battles that are helping you realign your mind to the way of Jesus. Psalm 1 says it beautifully, and I encourage you to check this out in your scriptures. It says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction." The psalmist describes the person who meditates on God's law as somebody who is blessed. Now, in context here, the Old Testament law is what the author of the psalm has in mind. And they were under the Old Covenant, right? So they had to obey law, and being right with God was a strong focus. They related to God by having good behavior. We have a different focus, though. Because we're under this new covenant, because of Jesus' death and his resurrection, our focus is actually on loving God and loving others. It's the more simple and yet far more demanding relationship with God that we get to enjoy as followers of Jesus. But Psalm 1 can still teach us that meditation has a benefit for the new covenant Christian life. It teaches us that there is a blessing on the person who meditates on the Lord and on his word. Blessed, that word, is a description of a person who's happy and a person who has God's divine favor upon them. This psalm teaches us that when we meditate, we can experience more happiness in our lives, and we experience more of God as we commune with him. Psalm 1 also teaches us that our meditation can develop our character. The psalm paints a picture with contrasts here, doesn't it? It contrasts the person who meditates on God's word with the wicked, sinners, and mockers. How is that a contrast between them and the person who meditates on God's word? Well, if the definition of Christian meditation is to hear God's voice and respond, then naturally a deeper, more Christ-like character will develop in us as we respond to God. Meditation helps us identify the areas in our life and where we need God to do some transformation. And as we repent, we invite the Holy Spirit to actually do that transforming work in our lives. So how do we actually do this meditation that the Bible invites us into? I'm going to give you some tips on specifics at the end, but right now, as you begin to embrace meditation as part of your ongoing spiritual workout routine, I want to encourage you to meditate on three things. First, meditate on God. What I mean is meditate, think upon, contemplate, consider the nature of who God is, his attributes. Because knowing the truth of who God is can be the anchor for us when life throws us for a loop or threatens to overwhelm us. Truths like how God is eternal, how, you know, God pre-existed for eternity before the earth was created, and how he's going to exist for all time after we are long gone. That can actually comfort us, knowing that nothing can stop, nothing can destroy the God who loves us and who is for us. Truths like how God is self-sufficient, that God has no needs, can actually remind us, right, that God doesn't need us to satisfy anything in him. Church, you need to know that God doesn't need you, but he wants you. God is not lacking in anything, but he delights in us, and he delights in our love and in our obedience to him. Truths like God is omnipotent, that he is all-powerful. Help us know that there's nothing that we're going to face that is too much for the living God. He who created the universe with a word cannot be undone by anything that we're experiencing. Truths like God is faithful, that he is wise, that he is just, that he is good. They all help us navigate our life. That God is love reminds us that despite how we feel sometimes, everything God does because he loves us, including sending his son Jesus to die on a cross for you so that you can be freed from your sin and find eternal life. The attributes of God are worth thinking about. They're worth meditating on because they are the anchor for our souls and the lens by which we interpret our lives. In addition to his attributes, though, it would actually benefit us to meditate on God's work, so on who he is and what he does. And to be honest, there's been seasons in my life where I kind of wondered what God was up to, times when I couldn't really see what God was doing. But then I come to this realization that the problem was not that God wasn't doing something, but that I either didn't know where to look or I was too busy to even try looking for the work of God. I kept looking for the spectacular when God was doing the quiet work inside people's hearts and in his lives. But by forcing myself to take time to meditate on what God is doing in the world, in the church, in my own heart, I found that God was actually far busier than I had assumed. Meditating on God's works reminds us that God is faithful to his people and that in him you are secure. When you ponder all that God has done throughout history in the scriptures and in the time from the scriptures till now, right? What he has done in your life individually and in our church, it should give you hope and encouragement to keep going, knowing that God's for you. He's not against you. He's on your team. So let me ask you something. How have you seen God work lately? What's he doing in your life, in your heart, and in our world? I'd love to hear those stories if you want to send them to me. What does that work that he's doing actually tell you about who he is? You see, meditating on God's attributes and on his works will strengthen your faith today and help prepare you to face all that is still to come in your life. So the first thing I encourage you to do is spend time meditating on God, on his attributes and on his works, so on who he is and what he has done. The second thing I want to encourage you to do is actually spend some time meditating on you, on yourself, on your feelings, your choices, and your circumstances. You know, after 20 years or so of pastoral counseling, one of the things I've noticed is that most people struggle to identify what they are feeling. I'll often hear people say, I feel bad about this or that. And I actually have to ask them to clarify what they meant when they said they feel bad. Because bad isn't really a feeling. Guilty, shameful, sad, frustrated, angry, lonely. Those are what people often mean when they say they feel bad. And the opposite can be true in the positive side, right? That we ask people, or people ask us, how are you doing? We say, oh yeah, I'm doing good. Well, what do we really mean? Well, we usually mean we're feeling happy, we're feeling energetic, we're feeling at peace. The ability to identify and articulate what you feel is key to understanding how God is shaping you. For example, if you feel angry, why do you feel angry? What is the source of your anger? Is it because of a current situation, or is it because of an old situation? The anger is still in you and something's just been stirring it up lately. Often the source of anger is a person who's hurt you, and the only way to move past it is to acknowledge the hurt, to acknowledge what you feel and what brought it about, and then practice forgiveness. So if you do feel angry, let me ask you, is there somebody in your life that you need to forgive? It's worth thinking about. You know, exploring these types of questions can actually help to lead you to freedom from your feelings, whatever they are, to keep them from controlling you. Not that you don't have feelings, but so that they don't control you. You can find greater peace and joy if you simply take stock of what you're feeling and why. And when you feel good, it's important to do the same thing. It's going to help determine what things you're doing in your life that make you feel happy, full of life, joyful. And then you can lean into those experiences and experience them more and more and more. So meditate on your feelings. Discern what you're feeling and the source that they come from. But also, I want to encourage you to meditate not just on your feelings, but on your choices. You know, our choices often have a major impact in our spiritual lives. Choosing to spend a whole day and night binge watching on Netflix might lead you to feel a little disconnected from God or from others. Choosing to go into debt for that new car may cause you some long-term regret and some financial hardship. But also choosing to go for a walk on a nice day can make you feel better and more alive. It's important to make choices in your life that bring glory to God. Galatians chapter 5 verse 25 says, "Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit." So as you meditate, think about your recent choices and think about the choices you have that are upcoming, right? Are you moving toward health in your body, in your mind, and in your soul? Or are you actually making choices that harm you instead of helping you? Are you moving towards health in relationships? These are things to be pondering as you look at the choices in your life. But while you're meditating about these things, I think you would do well to ruminate on your life circumstances as well. We're often slaves to our circumstances. We let them dictate our feelings, our choices, and even our connection to God. Right? But when we take those circumstances and really process them through Christian meditation, we can evaluate them differently and seek to know what God is doing in us through these circumstances and what God is calling us to do because of them. Maybe this trial that you're going through right now is actually your opportunity to have the breakthrough that you've been praying for. So meditating on your feelings, your choices, and your circumstances is a great way to realign yourself with God and to become stronger in your relationship with Jesus. So meditate on God, on who He is and what He has done, and meditate on yourself, on your feelings, your choices, and your circumstances. But also, lastly, meditate on Scripture. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 say, "All Scripture is God-breathed. It's useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." Now, I understand that for many people, reading, memorizing, studying the Bible is boring and difficult. But yet I want to tell you, it's key to your spiritual health. If you're honest, for many, reading the Bible is like the push-ups of a spiritual workout. But if you want to get stronger in your faith, then understanding the Scriptures and implanting them into your heart and into your mind is crucial. Harper Lee, the author of To Kill a Mockingbird, said, "The book to read is not the one that thinks for you, but the one which makes you think. No book in the world equals the Bible for that." So to help you either begin or maybe to begin again meditating on Scripture, I've got a couple pointers for you. First off, start with by reading one passage, story, or a chapter at a time. Don't try to read like the whole book of Matthew in one sitting. You will find that you have too much. It'd be like drinking from a fire hose. Break it down into something smaller. I want to encourage you, a second point is to reread it a couple of times in your sitting, right? Take your time with it. This is about slow cooking, not microwaving. Third thing is, resist the urge to figure it all out, like you're going to be the teacher of it, like you have to have all the answers. pastor and author Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, just as you do not analyze the words of somebody you love, but accept them as they are said to you, accept the word of Scripture and ponder it in your heart, as Mary did. That is all. That is meditation. So lastly, ask questions of the passage as you read it. Who am I in the story, right? Using your imagination, try to put yourself there to experience what happened, to picture the sea and feel the air blowing upon you. Use your imagination to go feel the heat of the desert and to experience all that the story would have for you. Put yourself in it and feel what they feel, right? And so when also ask questions like, God, what are you trying to say to me? Is God trying to give you an exhortation or an encouragement? An exhortation is a challenge, a way to do something differently. I'm challenging you to do this or to do that. An encouragement is, you know, God's just trying to help remind you who you are in Him. So what are the Scriptures saying in that way? And even what actions are the Scriptures calling to you is another question to ask of it. Is there something specific that you need to do because of what you've read? Meditating on Scripture is this exercise that's going to strengthen your faith tremendously. It's going to help you understand the will of God and help you rest in the love of God. Now, here are a few more tips for you to do as you begin to incorporate Christian meditation into your devotional life. One, know this, it looks a little different for everybody. For some people, they got to sit still in a comfortable chair. Other people have to kneel. Others need to go for a walk. For me, I find it's easiest when I do probably two activities, when I go for a walk or when I go for a drive. That's when I can best focus my mind to hear the voice of God. Sometimes we actually need to set aside multiple times in a day for meditation. Not everybody can set aside half an hour, an hour or more in a day to do this. You actually can break this up by doing this in like 5 or 10 minute chunks multiple times a day. Give yourself that breather, right? I want to let you know, do not be nervous if you face boredom, if you face loneliness or silence. These are natural parts, and in and of themselves, they actually have something to say to you. I want to encourage you to rid yourself from as many distractions as you can, to put your phone in another room, maybe get up before the kids get up, or wear noise-canceling headphones, whatever it takes to help you focus on hearing the voice of God. Remember that this is a lifetime journey. No one is the master that has it all figured out. So be patient with yourself. Allow yourself to grow into this and develop it slowly over time. And lastly, I encourage you to consider keeping a notebook beside you as you do it. You may find some insights that you need to write down and come back to later. I'm challenging you to meditate on God and meditate on yourself and meditate on Scripture. It's an easy thing to say, but it's a far more difficult thing to do. And I got to admit, I'm not a master at this. I struggle with the discipline of stopping and just being in the presence of God. But I want to get better and I want to get stronger. Do you want to join me? Why don't you pray with me? Gracious Father, I thank you that you give us these spiritual exercises that we might grow closer to you. And yet, God, I want to be very cognizant and be very thankful that these things do not make you love us more, but your love for us is complete and perfect in Christ Jesus, our Savior. That because we are made in the image of God and we are redeemed by the sacrifice of Christ, we are perfectly loved whether we do these things or not. But Lord, we want to love you better. We want to get stronger and know you deeper and more intimately. So therefore, we're going to try practicing some of these things. And I pray that through the Holy Spirit, you would help us to do that. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. And Lord God, we want to worship you. We recognize that everything we have is in you, that you are all that we need. We love you, we thank you, and we praise you in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
We thank you for gathering with us. We trust that this time, even online, has been a blessing to you. And may God bless you in your week and in all that you do. May you bear his name well and bring his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Blessings for this week.
All our hope is in you, oh God. These words are true. even as we strive to grow stronger in our faith, we have to remember that God's love is not a result of our effort, but is given to us graciously and freely through Jesus. So thank you, worship team, for that great reminder. Now, we want to do something new with you today, right? At the very end of our service, there's going to be a screen pop up with some questions on it that are related to today's teachings. These are so that you can either think through what was taught and internalize it, or if you are around some other people, you can talk about it and help each other grow. So when you see those questions, if you want to engage with them, just pause the screen and work through the questions. We want to thank you so much for joining us this week at North Park Stratford. We hope and trust that our service has both encouraged you and challenged you. Next week, we're going to be looking at the spiritual practice of prayer, and as we add another one of our exercises to help us get stronger in our faith. So I'd like to close our service with this benediction. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have the strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that you would be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen and amen. I hope you have a fantastic day, and we'll see you next time.